and welcome to the Scuttlebutt Podcast. Our guests today are, or guests, plural. We've got Frank Scappaticci and John Plumstead. Both are former West Point grads, college football players, and now both partners at their company, Gray Line Investments. John and Frank, welcome to the show.
Morning.
Good morning, man.
Good morning.
Thanks for having us on.
Yeah, thanks for being here. We're
John,
excited.
John, blank, good morning. Very, very, very good news, like.
John, I will say I'm happy to have you on because you put Tim in the running, or you and Tim are now in the running for best hair. So
there you go. I
appreciate you showing up prepared.
Yeah, I am. Yeah. I'm transitioning off active duty now. So I'm like in that weird, you know, spot between active duty hair and veteran hair. It's like almost impossible to make it look normal. So I need a couple months.
Oh yeah. It's looking good, man. It's looking good.
Yeah, thanks.
I don't know how many times I got stopped in that last like 2 months before going on terminal leave where, you know, they're getting the ruler out and they're like, this is really, really borderline. And I'm like, come on, man, just cut me some slack here.
I have 4 weeks left. Leave me alone.
No doubt. At the short timers, big time. But we're happy to have you guys on the show. You guys are podcast veterans. You got your own podcast. And so I think we're going to make for a good conversation today. You guys want to start out giving us a little bit of backstory about how you guys met each other and what brings you here today?
Sure. Go ahead, Frank.
Oh, I'm taking it. Okay. All right. So John and I, we know each other. We play football together. We were recruited athletes for the Army football team. So I think we arrived at West Point in 2005. Actually, John was 2004 because you went to the U.S. Military Academy prep school. So he was there earlier than me. We're teammates, played the same position for a while. So we were in direct competition for a few years. Then we both started, got some reps, had a strong friendship there. We also both branched field artillery. So we're both FA officers and got to go to lovely Fort Sill together in Lawton, Oklahoma. If you've never been, you're lucky, right? It's not the best TV station, if anyone is listening who's been there. But we went there. We both were stationed at Fort Carson, Colorado, which is an awesome duty station, in my opinion. And we went our separate ways, had families, kids. John stayed in the Army for a little bit longer. I got out after 5 years and started a real estate investment company 2 years ago together when COVID hit because we had some extra time in our schedule and we've been doing, you know, working our ass off ever since. So that's our 1 minute elevator pitch, I guess.
The down and dirty, the nitty gritty.
Yep.
Since you guys have so much of the same story, do we need to hear it from you too, John, or?
Oh, all good. I think Frank hit the big points. You know, we're like our friendship was kind of forged in like a locker room or on the gridiron. So like, you know, intense. Frank and I are very comfortable telling each other when we disagree, right? And in a passionate sense, if we need to. So we've always been able to kind of cut through the bullshit and been like, hey, this is what I think. This is what you think. You know, how can we figure out the middle ground? So we're really good at kind of resolving conflict and hopefully, you know, creating this culture between the two of us where the best idea wins. And I think that allows us to iterate our business all the time. And we're having a lot of fun doing it. So
unbelievable how like good of friends you can build, I think, just in the military in general. And I'm sure that the sports dynamic just kind of adds another layer to it. You talk about, or you hear people talk about the camaraderie of like a team or whatever. And I'm always like, well, you haven't been in the military, you wouldn't understand. But I'm sure that like stacked on top of like a military experience is just like another level. And I think one of the beauties of that is the quicker you can get to telling your best friend that they're full of shit, like the better. And the closer you kind of become and you kind of cut that curve out.
Well, I'll add to it. I remember, I don't know if John remembers this, but it was over a year ago. And, you know, we've fired people in our company, like most young companies before. And at one point, John was like, hey, man, like, there's no guarantees our friendship makes it out as this thing alive either. You know, like, because it's a business. Like, business can always go into stress a friendship. Like a married couple goes into business together, their marriage is at risk too, right? Like businesses put stress on relationships. And I think that's part of like the locker room, like from 12 years ago coming back, because a sports team is a meritocracy, right? Like the best players play and the worst players get cut, you know? And I think John and I, for better or for worse, got a little bit of that in our blood and we can't shake it, you know? So we, I think there's something there, but I think we're a little bit wired differently. We're a little aggressive, I think, in how we treat each other, I guess. So,
well, I think you have to be like that. It was almost the same exact thing when we were interviewing the guys from the Dead Reckoning Collective. That's exactly what they said too. Is like, man, no, like we're quick to like fight each other. Like if we live next to each other, we'd be rebuilding the fence every couple weeks. And that's like especially if you're going into business with each other, like you have to be able to kind of like brothers, you know, like if you guys had brothers growing up, like you get into a fight with your brother and then 2 hours later, you're like, you want to play Mario Kart? Like, you know what I mean? Like you just squash it and move on.
Yeah, that's like our entire childhood right there. I like
that. If you guys have any like notable disagreements or like points early on in your kind of relationship, either with football or school or whatever, that like kind of maybe tested you guys or like really put your friendship on the line?
I would just say being, when Frank and I started at West Point, we were both linebackers and we were in a linebacker room that had 36 guys on it. And three of those players started, right? So you look at the depth chart and you know, Frank and I are deep on the depth chart and we look at each other and we look at everyone else in the room. And it's like, I will punch you in the face to get out on that field. And I will punch everyone else out, or, you know, everyone else in the face to get on that field. And, you know, after a month, the room was smaller. After a year, the room was smaller yet. After 4 years, you know, Frank and I were sitting next to each other in the front of the room. And, you know, there's a million little stories that took us to get to that point, right? But the story is a successful story. But if you were to zoom in, what you would see is a ton of failures where we were at each other's throats or we were at our teammates' throats or, you know, we're fighting, clawing, scratching everything we could to see the field and start contributing. So I think it's just that adversity that happened throughout those 4 years. Then you go into the military, you know, and as you're a young officer, or, you know, young in the military, you get punched in the face every day there. You have all kinds of failures there. And you get to the business world and it's just as, if you're doing it right, in my opinion, if you're doing business right, it's just as cutthroat as college athletics and it's just as cutthroat as the military.
That's probably good advice. I think that everybody's taken a few of those punches. Probably anybody that's listening has had their fair share of those, that's for sure. So you guys said that before we started recording, you guys said that you were both stationed at the same place?
Yeah, we were stationed Fort Carson, Colorado, which is in Colorado Springs, which is an amazing spot. I still fantasize about the breakfast spots on Tejon Street. It's like the best breakfast in the military is like downtown Colorado Springs. They have like three world-class breakfast spots next to all the bars. Really, really, really good duty station. But we didn't actually spend a lot of time together when we were there. John deployed to Afghanistan first. And then I, right after he came back, or maybe right before, I deployed to RC West. We both went to RC West, which is also interesting. So our path has literally been exactly the same. Artillery officers, same duty station, deployed to the same area of operations, just on separate timelines. So we didn't spend a lot of time with each other, actually, until we got back into real estate a couple of years ago. So during the military, we only hung out like probably a handful of times, I would say, while we were stationed there.
And do you guys live in the same place now?
No, I live about 20 minutes north of Manhattan in Westchester, and John just moved to Tampa.
So both the East Coasters then. How does that work? Were you guys, obviously you were good friends on the football field, while you were playing football together, and then you are in the Army, and then does like somebody reach out to the other person and say like, hey, let's go into this real estate investment company together? Or like, who reached out to who? Was it like a mutual thing? How does that work?
I think we're both investing in real estate and we had talked about it. Like we'd see each other at football games and talk on the phone here and there. And we'd talk about it. It was like, yeah, Frank was doing great stuff with real estate. I was doing great stuff with real estate. And then I think we were kind of both had the same feeling at the same time, late 2019, early 2020, where we kind of wanted to go to the next level, right? Like we weren't exactly sure what that meant, but we wanted to say, hey, what would happen if we were more deliberate about it? We initially started talking, not necessarily to join forces, but just like, hey, if you were going to take it to the next level, what would you do, right? And it just became clear that I think we're in a pretty similar place in life with pretty similar goals. Maybe we should at least try to do some of this together. So we started looking at houses. We had some ideas of what we wanted to do. Our goal for 2020 was 10 houses. We thought we were basically going to supplement retirement, right? Like, let's start picking up houses. And then things started going well and we started kind of feeding off each other and the feedback mechanism and the iterations were going really well. And before you know it, in the first 6 months, we had bought 50 houses. So instead of 10, we did 50. And we were kind of looking at each other like, shit, man, like this is working. We are jiving. We're learning really fast. Like, let's try to do 100 houses. So that was our next goal.
Yeah. Well, to be clear, we were wholesaling the majority of those, right? So just for anyone listening, we didn't keep most of those under management. We kept some, but most of them we flipped the contracts, as some people say. I'll add to it though. At that time, I had already been out of the Army. John was a major. I guess you're technically still a major.
Yeah, I'm still active duty. I'm transitioning off right now, but I'm still active duty right now. Yep.
Right. And I had gotten out as a captain. So I've been working in New York City for over 5 years at that point. And I was a consultant, worked at JP Morgan after I left Ernst & Young. And I was coming to the conclusion, I was like, I have been on this path for 5 years and I don't like this path. Like, I don't like being in a large bureaucratic organization. Like, the Army has an excuse, they don't turn a profit. But in my opinion, when a private company that's supposed to turn a profit or even a public one, like has all that red tape, it just feels even stupider. I'm like, hey, the money's right there. Like, let's go, right? So that's not their fault. Big organizations need to turn slow. They need to be more deliberate. And it just wasn't the right fit for me. So when John called me and was like, hey, let's experiment with this real estate stuff, I was like, hey, maybe this could turn into something that's a real opportunity. And thank God it, you know, I'm very thankful that it started to snowball because I left my job about a year ago and I'm doing this full time. So it was, I think it's kind of lucky that John called, which is good.
What were you doing at Ernst & Young and JP Morgan?
I was in like the digital, like some people call it digital transformation type consulting, right? So we would go to like, we did a large project for Fannie and Freddie. They had to merge like their technology platforms. I worked on stuff like that. JP Morgan had a similar program pop up in 2017. Then I went over there, worked there for a couple of years. And that was my last job in financial services.
So you were kind of working adjacent with the mortgage and like kind of real estate space already before, and then also maybe doing stuff on the side before this kind of leading up to John calling.
Yes, but I would say you don't learn anything about real estate investing though in that environment. Like helping Fannie and Freddie figure out how they pool mortgages and how they disclose information to investors doesn't make you a good single family or multifamily investor, right? It's a completely different skill set. I just was fascinated by real estate really after I bought my primary residence. I was like, man, looking at like single family houses is cool. like, which is not really like a good reason to get into single family investing, but it is the reason I started getting interested in it. I was like, damn, this thing was fun. I enjoyed it. And John and I also probably noticed our rentals in the Colorado Springs area appreciating like 150% between 2013 and 2018 or 19. And we're like, damn, we should have bought more real estate, you know? So there's a bunch of other different reasons.
So to break it down kind of like Barney style, if you will, when you started out, you were buying these houses ideally to rent them out, or were you buying them with the intentions of flipping them?
We started with the intention to hold on to everything. Like, hey, let's just buy 10 houses or 10 units. Maybe it's a couple quadplexes, whatever. And let's get some cash flow. And then 20 years from now, we're going to be better off for it, right? That was the original thought process. But deals are very hard to come by, right? As a lot of people are aware of, single family, small multifamily is extremely competitive, more competitive than maybe it's ever been, maybe. And it was competitive in 2019 and 20 too. So we were like, hey, if we're going to do this and we want to get good deals, we got to do direct to seller marketing, which is what wholesalers and flippers who are professionals, that's what they do. So we started sending out text messages. We started making cold calls. We started hiring virtual assistants shortly after having some success. And we kept kind of iterating and snowballing that machine. And I think we got lucky. Our first 2 months, we closed like six deals, and we made a good amount of money. And we were like, oh, this is so easy. Like, this is going to be the easiest thing of all time. We're going to be so rich in like a month. You know, like we thought it was going to be really, really easy and really quick. And we learned later that it is hard, right? Like we got a little bit of beginner's luck mixed in with that. But we did scale that business pretty fast.
So you were originally buying houses thinking, hey, we'll get renters in these. We'll hold these for the long term and kind of juice our retirement. Were you outsourcing the property management to like a manager or were you guys dealing with that yourself?
We tend to outsource all property management, dealing with tenants and collecting the rents and the tax documents, all that stuff. I think if you're focused on finding deals, especially in single family and small multifamily, it's going to make sense to outsource that work, right? Because 90% of the value in our business is found, is realized from finding good deals, not squeezing out, you know, 10% of the monthly rent by self-managing, right? Or maybe 8%.
So then does that kind of lead up into the wholesaling? And will you kind of, maybe for anybody listening that is unfamiliar with wholesaling, walk us through that process? What is wholesaling? Why does that work?
Well, I think it started with the BRRRR strategy, which BRRRR is B-R-R-R-R. So four R's, it's acronym, right? So B is buy, and then it is rehab, and then it is rent, and then it is refinance, and it's repeat, right? So what that means is you buy a house, you fix it up, you put a renter in there, and then hopefully you can refinance your money out of there and do it again. But the trick of that, the math to make that process work, and it's an amazing strategy, but the math to make that work is you have to figure out how to buy properties at about 80% or less of what they're worth. If you can find deals that are 20% off, you can keep snowballing it over and over and over, okay? So we said, okay, well, to start the BRRRR method, this refinancing method, we have to be able to find deals for 20% off, right? So we found a deal at 20% off. We're like, oh, great, right? Let's try to find another deal at 20% off. But you start realizing if you're going to do any of this marketing, you should do some volume of this marketing, right? Like if you're going to send text messages or cold calls or direct mail, if you send one email, you should probably send 1,000 or 10,000, right? So we start sending all, right? If you're gonna do it. So we start marketing, and then before you know it, like we have more properties than we can buy. We don't have enough money. We don't have enough bandwidth. We're like, we don't want to own all these properties. What should we do? We could say, hey, Mr. Seller, even though you'll sell us this house for 20% off, we're not interested in it, right? But instead of doing that, we said, hey, why don't we try to team up with another investor and say, hey, other investor, do you want this deal? And, you know, maybe we can get this deal at 75% of value. Maybe you'll pay 80% of value and we'll keep that 5% difference. Seller's happy to get rid of the property. Investor's happy. We keep that 5% difference, right? Well, we did that once and we're like, actually, when we do that, we get paid faster than if we do the BRRRR strategy. Oh, and by the way, we're pretty good at marketing and we can go to multiple markets and it's COVID. So people are comfortable selling their house over the phone now for the first time in the history of the United States. So it was kind of like the perfect storm of all those things that came together. And we're like, all right, let's hire, you know, 20 virtual assistants. Let's send thousands and thousands of text messages and phone calls. And let's try to do as many of these as we can. And that's what we did. It's like the golden years of wholesaling, but it only lasted for about 18 months. And then everything changed.
So wholesaling, you're essentially, you guys are putting in the work to find these deals that you can buy at a certain price. And where you guys make the money is finding somebody that will buy it at a higher price. And you just keep whatever the difference is of those.
Exactly.
Okay.
So
I could see how volume would be. That's everything in that. That 5% is, I guess, I don't know. What location are you guys working in? How much is that 5%? Or at least in this example, value of homes are you looking at?
We're like $100,000 to $150,000 homes, but think about a wholesale fee. Your average wholesale fee is going to be, you know, you call it 10 grand to 15 grand, right? Like right in that sweet spot, you know? So as long as you can find deals for 3 to 5 grand, if you can find deals for $3,000 to $5,000, and then you get paid $15,000, $10,000 to $15,000 on the back end, you're probably going to be okay. The problem is as you start doing more and more, what happens to your margin? Instead of that 5%, you're like, oh, 4%'s good. Oh, actually 3%. Before you know it, you're like, you know, you're instead of making $10,000, you're making $7,000. And instead of costing you $3,000 to get a deal, now it's costing you $6,000 to get a deal. And you're like, wait, what happened to all this money we were counting on?
What were you going to say, Tim?
I was going to say, it sounds like in the car business, like a pass-through, essentially. Like you're the middleman at that point. Like you're just kind of facilitating the deal, saying like, this is the seller, this is the buyer, everybody works with me, and then I will take that difference. Is that pretty accurate?
Yeah, you're taking the spread. That's You know, there's more creative strategies you can use to be the middleman. Like there's seller financing and all this stuff, but generally when people say wholesaling, the profits they're making is the spread. That is the profit.
It's the simplest process in real estate. It's not the easiest process in real estate, but it is the simplest, right? Like if you can find a deal that someone else wants, you can keep that difference in theory.
I'm kind of like thinking the person that's listening to the podcast that's transitioning out of the military and they want to get into this. My initial thought would be, I don't have $150,000 in the bank to like go buy my first house. Did you guys have that money? Where's the money coming from to start out?
So I would say, we're older, right? Like I'm 34, John's 35, and we have kids. We have some money to invest, right? Like
sure, of course. We're
probably older than the average person getting out of the military. So, but we don't have unlimited, right? We don't come from money either. So we were, like John said, at some point we were like, shit, we can't buy this stuff. So we got to find another strategy. So let's say that's you, right? Like what options do you have? Well, if you're buying stuff at a discount, a lot of the times we'll be talking to sellers and we'll say, we'll buy a cash, right? Cash is an incentive. People will drop their price to a cash buyer because it usually ensures speed and assurance that it's going to close. There's no lender involved that can drop the deal for you or screw up the deal. No appraisals, all that stuff. But we didn't have hundreds of thousands of dollars of cash, right? So how do we do that? Well, there's lending instruments set up for that. There's lending products for these types of transactions. They're called hard money loans, and they're higher interest rate and they're shorter duration. So if you were like, hey, I want to buy this house for $100,000. I don't have $100,000, but Frank, give me the $100,000. I'm going to say, okay, Tim, I'll do it for you. I'll close in 2 weeks, but I'm going to charge you 10% interest, maybe $1,000 at closing extra. And you got to pay me back the full amount in a year. All right. So that means you got a year to sell that house or refinance that house. So you got pressure on you and you got to pay higher rates, but you can close. And so it only makes sense to do that loan though, if you're going to turn a nice profit, right? Like, so you have to have some equity or you have to get a good price, right? So that's how that economy works. You can also ask your friends for that money and draw up the documents like, hey, Brock, your uncle's got $10 million. Can I borrow some money from him? And you'll drop the documents and do this exact same thing with a private lender, they call it. So that's how you would do it if you wanted to take stuff down but didn't have the cash.
That all sounds like a super appealing process, but to me, like as somebody who's never done this before, I am like a normally very risk averse person. I see a lot of like factors going into play. You know, you're borrowing money from somebody at like a knowably higher, you know, yield or whatever interest rate that you're paying, kind of guaranteeing that you can do something in the future. Whereas like, and then you also have the economy over the last like couple of years is all over the place. It's whipsawing, you know, you got people, nobody wants to sell, then all of a sudden everybody wants to sell. How are you balancing that type of like, that would just like, I feel like I'd wake up in a panic every day thinking that I wasn't going to be able to like get out from under something.
I mean, let's just call the elephant in the room is this, like single family flippers, when the economies tend to go into recessions, tend to get their ass kicked for a period of time, right? So like the risk you're alluding to is a real risk, right? If you had a hard money loan out in late 2007, early 2008, when the markets crashed on those particular weeks and the housing market stalled, I mean, you probably were in a tough spot. So I think the only way you can be sure you're hedging your risk is to not overpay on your purchase price. Like that's the best way to protect yourself, is to get the best deal possible. Because every dollar that you overpay is risk you just inherited, right? Which is why it's so hard. It's hard to acquire properties at a discount. That's why in the long run, it's a challenging business.
And I would assume too, like my mind immediately goes to like, okay, I'm starting out. I have 50 grand in the bank, but let me use this financing tactic that you're talking about. I'll do that 2, maybe 3 times, make enough money where I don't even need the financing. Then now I'm just like my own lender, like I'm using my liquid cash, because I would assume that you do a handful of houses. Well, now you've made enough money where you can just go and like, now you're able to call people and say, hey, I got cash. I'll buy your house for X amount. Let's get this going.
Right. Right. I think what you can do to make sure you're not overexposed is, banks would call it like a pressure test, right? They'll say, okay, let's look at my portfolio and how much exposure I have to single family. What's my total debt amount? What's my total interest payments that I make every month? Let's assume assets drop 20%. What does my picture look like now? What if assets drop 40%? I'm talking about houses in this case. What does it look like? At what number am I in trouble, right? Like, you, I think on a quarterly basis, you should look at that stuff and be like, am I taking on too much? Like, if I have 10 grand in the bank account, I shouldn't have $2 million in loans, right? There's like, your wealth and your liquidity should influence how much debt you take on. So if it's your first rodeo and you only have a little bit of money, just do one deal at a time, mm-hmm. You know, like, you know, and plus the lender is going to might require that of you anyway. Lenders might ask for your bank account balances. You're going to run your credit, all that stuff. So there's systems in place to prevent people from going nuts, although they're not always perfectly executed.
The one of the other things I would say is, one is proceed at your own caution, right? Like, this is a dangerous business where lots of people have done stupid stuff and lost all their money. A few other things that we do in our business to try to curb that downside risk is, one, we always play in the middle of the market. What does that mean? That means that we don't do, you know, really crappy houses, and we don't do really nice houses. We do houses that are in the middle, right? So if you think of, you know, whatever city you live in, you have like the area where the doctors and the lawyers live. Like, we never flip those houses. We don't mess with those at all. We do houses where the plumber lives and the teacher lives and where middle America lives. Why? Because when prices drop, when the bottom falls out, the middle market's going to do a lot better than the top market, right? So we try to stay away from the top market. The other thing we try to do is we try to make sure all the flips that we have, if the bottom fell out and we had to hold on to them as rentals, we could hold on to them as rentals. Again, what would this house rent for if we can't sell it and we just have to hold it for 2 years as a rental? What do those numbers look like? So we, you know, we take risk and we use hard money loans and we're aggressive guys, but we say, hey, if everything goes to hell and the market does drop 20% and we can't sell it, how do we make sure that we don't lose
money? It's good having that backstop in mind and kind of like your safety net. You can always kind of revert to cash later versus cash now. You know, you're getting your wholesale fee versus, you know, you get it in rent over the coming couple of years. You mentioned—
It's one of those things Warren Buffett says, and it's so simple, it's stupid, but people forget about it. Like, rule number one, don't lose money. Rule number two, don't forget rule number one, right? There's so many people that forget that though, right? It's like in a real estate transaction, it's so easy to lose money. So if you're just thinking about like the high side, right? Like, what if this goes well? Like, you're going to get screwed eventually. So, you know, I'm naturally a very optimistic person, but Frank and I have built our system to spend a lot of time saying what can go wrong with this deal, because we know if we don't lose money, chances are we're going to make money. Sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off, Brock, but I thought it was an important point.
No, that is good. You, Frank, you said something earlier, you guys really try to focus on, you know, the money to be made is by buying houses at a discount. How do you guys think about looking at houses, and other than saying, hey, we'll come to you with cash, give us a 20% discount, what kinds of things are you guys looking for that would maybe lead to a house being available at a discounted price? You said you guys are using virtual assistants and doing cold calls. Are you getting 20% discounts from people who aren't advertising that they're selling their house? Are you really focusing on markets that you know really well, and you just can personally say, oh, that house isn't worth that? You know, what kind of approach are you guys taking?
Well, you're looking for a homeowner or maybe a landlord that has a problem to solve in most cases. People don't give their homes away for 80% of what it's worth unless there's usually something wrong, right? So that comes back to your data, right? So who do you send the messages to? And there's lists that you can pull that help you send your messaging to the right person, right? So a landlord that's owned a home for more than 5 years, for example, is a decent prospect because there's a lot of landlords don't keep up maintenance on their properties, as you guys are probably aware. So there's a lot of landlords out there with really crappy houses that won't appraise if someone tries to buy it with a bank loan, right? Like a bank just won't lend on the house because it has so much deferred maintenance. So landlords tend to, it's funny, you think landlords are all like really savvy investors, but ironically, they make some of the best people to buy houses from because they're not emotionally attached to the property and a lot of them are not good at it, right? So that's one demographic. And then what a lot of other people do to identify distress is people with foreclosure, tax liens. We bought houses from people. I remember one of our first deals, I was the acquisitions person. This is back when all of us were doing everything. Like there was no structure in the company. I was on the phone with the guy. He's like, yeah, if I don't sell the house in the next 3 weeks, the bank's taking it. I'm like, 3 weeks? I'm like, you haven't even listed the property? He's like, nah, I just didn't take care of it. It slipped my mind. I'm like, well, like I can buy it, you know? Like he was screwed.
Like so, blood in the water right there.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
Yeah, I mean, if we didn't buy the house, he wasn't going to make any money at all, right? So he had almost no options, unfortunately, for that person. And sounds a little like even more cutthroat than our opening, right? Like this business, but that actually is what happens, right? Like 5 to 10% of the houses in the United States are in distress at any given moment in time. And those houses are moved on the secondary market, right? And they're bought cash. And that's how this market works.
I'd imagine too, that there were amidst like a very large transition in terms of like who is owning these houses too, because, and we can talk about this a little bit later. We had mentioned it before we started recording about buying businesses that are for sale. Something that Tim and I have been talking a bunch about and like taking over businesses / in this case, rentals from older people looking to retire. I would imagine that there's a lot of people in that position that are just like ready to kind of cut the ties and, you know, go enjoy their retirement. Has that been your guys' experience that you've seen so far?
It was until 2021. And then what happened in 2021? Every newspaper in the country said the real estate market's on fire. So even grandma, who, you know, doesn't know anything about real estate, she read in the newspaper every day for a couple months that the real estate market was on fire. So now everyone thinks their house is worth a ton of money. Whether it is or it isn't doesn't matter, right? So what does that mean? That means if you're trying to find a distressed seller, even someone that is distressed, they don't look at themselves in the mirror and see themselves as being distressed. They think they're rich. So that's why a lot of investors are really struggling right now, because the only way we can make money, flippers, wholesalers can make money, is if you don't pay retail, if you find a deal. And when the market is really hot, it's really hard to find deals.
Yeah.
Has the has rent deferment impacted what you guys do at all? I know with the COVID thing, I don't know exactly what the laws have been, but know several people that have rentals and tenants have been able to claim like inability to pay. And that like pushes that out and you can't evict them. Has that impacted what you guys do at all?
Not as much for us, but it definitely has affected a lot of others. We started this business when COVID was already underway. So like the moratoriums, the eviction rules that we've laid out, that was all happening like real time as we started the company. So we very naturally started just gravitating towards markets where it was more friendly towards landlords, because at the beginning, our best buyers were also landlords. It was like our best seller was landlords, and then our best buyers were landlords, right? On the wholesaling business. So naturally we went to states where if it was already tenant occupied and we're selling that house, a landlord would still want to buy it, meaning that the eviction laws were not as adverse to landlords. So it hasn't affected us as much. Although I know in New York where I live, this is a really big deal, right? Landlords are getting crushed over here. So it's state dependent, I guess is what I'm saying.
And the other thing is we're virtual real estate investors, so we could pick anywhere to invest. So we wanted to pick states that had favorable landlord tenant laws. And we also wanted to pick states that had strong real estate markets. And it just so happens that you know, Texas, Florida, Georgia, North Carolina, Tennessee. They tend to be red states. They tend to have favorable landlord laws, and they also happen to have really strong real estate markets.
So you guys hire a bunch of virtual assistants. You're sending out mail, sending text messages, calling people left and right, and basically just asking who wants to sell their home. Is that kind of the long and the short of it, at least on the wholesaling side?
Yeah, that's it, right? Like Frank said, how we try to get the best list, right? Like ultimately though, you know, you could just open the phone book and start calling people. You would just probably have to call a lot more people, but it's still the same concept. Is even with a distress list, we're going to call 1,000 people until we find someone that wants to sell their house, or some ratio depending on the list and depending on the time of year and stuff, right? But it's a whole lot of no's. I would like to say from a high character moral standpoint, it, you know, some people may infer like, hey, are you guys taking advantage of these guys, right? If these people are in distress, if they can't make their payment, are you guys predatory? Are you going, hey, grandma, give me your house before the bank takes it? One is, there's no way for you to know what we're saying on our phone calls, but we try to be a company that has high character and does the right thing, right? But here's the big thing of it, and this is how I look at it, is without wholesalers or flippers or investors, these houses don't get sold, right? Like that house that is getting ready to go into foreclosure, who buys that if it's not an investor? No one, right? Real estate agents are not equipped to handle that. Real estate agents are not equipped to list properties on the MLS that won't pass appraisal. They can do that, but most of them won't because they're not comfortable doing that, right? So this little piece, this little niche that Frank and I and other investors fit for helping these distressed sellers, there's no one else that's coming to the call, right? So it's really easy to be like, hey, these investors are taking advantage of people that are in distress situation. We've had the phone calls on, or we've had many phone calls with people where, you know, they think it's because of God that we've called and we're helping them, you know, through this situation. So just understand that it's really easy being outside this world to be like, you know, these guys might be scumbags, and hey, maybe we are. You can be your own judge. But I would say that if investors aren't helping this part of the ecosystem, there's no one else there that's going to help.
Mm-hmm. Well, and trust me, nobody understands what it's like to be seen as a scumbag like me. I sell cars for a living, so I'm a car salesman.
Literally is a scumbag, so
yeah, you big don't even scumbag. Need to... Oh yeah. No, but it's a fine line between like, oh, I'm, at least in my case, I'm sure in your case and any other business, like you're there to make money. So like people have to understand too, like just to put it into perspective for my own world, like when I take a truck in on trade or whatever, of course you're going to get the people that are like, well, I could sell this for $5,000 more. And I'll just tell people like, absolutely. So can I, that's why I'm offering you this, is because I need to make money on it. Mm-hmm. Or, you know, people will get mad that their payment's so high. I'm not there to be somebody's financial advisor. This is the car you said you wanted. This is the payment on it. You know? Mm-hmm. So, I think that people need to look at it in a business lens too, and realize like, you're not doing this for fun. Like you're there to make money on it. But there's also the difference between like being a scumbag and like making money, you know? So I totally get what you're saying.
Well, there's also like, there's the ethics of dealing with the outside world, right? Like any business controls some level of pricing, right? As a car salesman, you want to sell it probably at the highest price you possibly can, right? If you're a plumber, sometimes you might charge a customer more than another customer, right? We all know plumbers that do stuff like that. So externally, people are like, man, pricing's really opaque. That's really messed up that business owners do that type of stuff, right? Like that's the attitude the public has. Here's the other attitude the business owner has though. I got employees, right? They use the funds that I pay them to feed their kids, mm-hmm. right? Which is probably has a bigger impact to them than any of your customers outside the company, right? Those are actually the most important people you have. They're depending on you to turn a profit. If you don't turn a profit, you can't keep them around, right? Business owners can't work for free. So like, I look at it like this, like, hey, yes, sometimes we increase prices in our storage business, for example, sometimes we do this, but hey, like these 6 to 8 people that depend on Grayline to go home and get their bonuses and make their car payments, like that's got to get done, you know? So businesses mm-hmm. have to increase prices and be aggressive with marketing to make this shit work. That's just the way the world operates.
Sales is a very hard business as it is. And like you said, Tim, I think it gets a bad rap in a lot of ways, but there are so many things that just modern consumers take advantage or take for granted, you know, just being able to go to the grocery store and buy literally whatever you want. But, you know, the supply chain has been like such a big thing in the news the last couple of years. Like, you know, there are hundreds of boats just sitting outside the pier. Like, somebody's paying those people to be there. And like, you know, just because you paid a dollar for this item, you know, 6 weeks ago, doesn't mean it costs the same that it does now. And so, yeah, it's finding that balance. And I think in the long run, it will work itself out. But short term blips like this cause a huge impact. Yeah. I'm curious, you guys talked about how you have some rentals. And I think that that is a place that is very attractive for military members, like really go-getter people that are active still really talk about like, oh, getting all these rentals going and whatever. Talk to us about the property management aspect piece. When should somebody consider having a property manager? When should they not? What kinds of things should they look for? Walk us through kind of what you guys think about that piece and how that might apply to some of our poor folks still on active duty out there grinding.
I think you should have a property manager no matter what. Like, if you're active duty, really? Hire a property manager. Yeah, like, if you've ever been through an eviction, like, dude, you don't want to deal with that. Someone who has repetitioned that process 7 times is going to be way less stressed than you doing it your first time. And it costs a couple of $1,000. So like, it only costs like 8 to 10% of the monthly rent. Like, if you're in a military base, that usually means like you're paying that property manager like $90 to $120 a month, right? To take that work off your plate. Like, I would say this, make sure you're charging the right rent, like the higher rent, to make room for the property manager, and don't under rent and pay them that fee no matter what. Honestly, like, some people like to self-manage, but imagine you had more than 3 rentals. Like, that starts to become a full-time job real quick. It's just, it's really hard to scale that. So I would say do it right away. It's my opinion.
I like the way you think. Yeah. I think I'm of the similar mindset and about to kind of go through this process myself. So kind of a selfish question. Tim and I both bought homes this last year. Not together, like separately and in different
we
parts
live,
of the country.
We live together. We are.
I wish.
We're a couple.
I really wish.
Wait, where are the houses?
Tim lives in Boise, Idaho, and I live in Norfolk, Virginia.
Nice. Boise's blowing up.
Dude, it's getting crazy, man. It's actually like to the point now we have so many, I don't want to just say Californians, but that's like the majority of it. So many people from California moving here that it's like getting to the point now where it almost doesn't make sense for people financially to move from California to here, because a year and a half, 2 years ago, they're selling their house in California for $1.5 million, coming out here, buying a beautiful home for $400,000, and now they're pocketing $1 million. And it's like to the point where that money that they're making by moving out here is like almost not worth it. Mm. It's crazy. It's wild. I think it's like the fastest growing area in the country, or at least top 5, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I read that. I'm from Boise. Good for a car salesman.
Yeah. Oh, it's very prices. it's very good, because we get these people that are not used to snow or mountains or camping, and they come in with their BMWs and their Mustangs, and they're like, I need a truck. And I'm like, yeah, you're in Idaho now. You do need a truck. Let me show you. So
they sold the house for $1.5 million, $400,000 went to the house, and the rest went to a boat and a truck to pull it.
That's right.
Awesome. I'm from Boise originally, and it has just been insane to watch how that development just kind of exploded overnight. That area is kind of unique in that the supply is very limited just due to the geographics of like where the kind of how the valley sits. But yeah, that's the rest of the city has not caught up with that and not really able to handle the infrastructure, and minimum wage is still $7.25 there. So a lot of locals are not going to be able to afford to live there for much longer. That's for sure.
Let's get into the kind of the start of the business and that story, like the turbulence that you guys hit. And yeah, I know you had said before we were recording, you kind of expanded too quick and you had to re-shrink down and reevaluate. Tell me about that.
Well, I think I'll go first and then John will, I'm sure, have a different perspective, but we started as a side hustle in reality, right? Like, which we alluded to before. We didn't plan for this to become our full-time jobs. It just so happened that way. And we had other team members that worked with us on this side hustle at the beginning. And we were like, hey, like, you still got to draw up legal documents and have an LLC to have the bank account set up. So our operating agreements and everything was like, hey, we're all partners, equal partners in the business. And we just started going, starting to make money. And we had virtual assistants hired and we started building systems and processes, but we really didn't outline the roles and responsibilities of the partners that well. And we should have done that earlier because we started to evolve into a real company, but then our partnership was still behaving as like a side hustle, right? Like there was no hierarchy. There was no like expectation of like when the people were going to quit their jobs and become full-time. Contributions were not equal amongst all the partners, right? And you start running into these, you know, this is a story that's probably been told a million times, right? Like people that have went through this type of journey. And, you know, so we went through this tough period where we, you know, bought out some partners, right? We had to, you know, we're like, hey, we're going to move forward with this team, this subset of the team. So we bought some people out and that was tough, right? Like that was really, really hard. One of the partners is my best friend. I still talk to him all the time, you know? And wasn't really his fault, but he just had a medical device job that was taking up a lot of his time. And he's a smart guy. He's still doing well. But John and I think our level of commitment kept going up and up and up and up. And our other partners were not going to be able to keep up with us. So we had to some tough decisions to make about 7 months into our business.
What does that conversation like that look like? You know, you've said something earlier about getting into business with like your family or friends. That's got to be a hard conversation to have.
Yeah, I have to assume it's an uncomfortable, like that's got to be an uncomfortable conversation.
Terrible. That whole month was miserable. Like John and I were like up till 10 p.m., 11 p.m., like that whole week of making those calls, being like, shit, this is terrible. You know, I honestly don't think I'll ever be able to work with a family or friend again. I think John and my relationship's a little different because we can yell at each other and still be okay, right? But most friendships I don't find are like that. And it was very painful. So I think I'll avoid it, to be totally honest, in the future. But I think the right way to do it is like, hey, it's to say exactly what's going on. Like, hey, I think our level of commitments to the business are going to go in different directions over time. And I don't think it's fair to our employees to have an untenable situation perpetuate for too much longer. So this is what I'd like to do. It sounds really direct, but that I think that's the only way to get through that conversation. Like eventually that has to come out.
Yeah.
Because if you leave any ambiguity there, you're doing both persons a disservice because you're just leading them along. So eventually that got out and sucked. Like firing people and moving on from partnerships is painful, man. It sucks.
Well, I think it says something. It speaks highly of you guys, your ability to like still be involved with those people and still be friends with them. That to me seems like you probably handled it with as much grace as possible and, you know, were respectful or as much as you could.
I definitely think it's one of those things where like, if you kick someone out of the boat, it doesn't matter how you do it. Like they're out of the boat and they're going to be pissed. Right. But then in that moment, you know, you can, you know, to kind of hijack Michelle Obama's quote, right. Of like trying to stay high when the shit hits the fan. Right. Like trying to take the high road, you know, and I think in those situations, there's all this emotion and things that we wanted to say. We could have said things that we would have regretted. We could have said things that were emotional and showed our frustration. But Frank and I tried really hard to be like, hey, we fucked up, man. And this is where we are today. And this is how we're going to move forward and understand that, you know, you're probably not happy about it, but that's how we're going to move forward. How do we move forward within those conditions, right? And it sucks. Like it really sucks.
Yeah, I think we fumbled the communications more than we're leading on. Like it was just like, it's one of those things, the first time you go through something like this, like you're gonna not do it perfect. Like I think right now we sound like, yeah, we handled this transition super well. And I look back on it and I'm like, I don't think it was that clean. Like it's messy, sure. Man. It's hard to deliver something that clean. So let's not give ourselves too much credit. It was not awesome.
Well, it sounds like you guys at least separated business from your emotions, like your own personal feelings on it.
I think now we have. But yeah. I think that took a couple months.
There might have been some choice words at the time.
Yeah. I think we've all overcome, and I think our friendships are where they need to be. But it took a little bit.
We've also though had to we've probably fired probably close to 20 people since then. Lots of virtual assistants and stateside people that our business went in a different direction, or they weren't keeping up with the business, or they were hired for one job and then we needed them to do another job. So Frank and I now look at this business like it's our baby, and we care about it to a very high degree. And if people can't keep up, we're going to have a tough decision or a tough discussion and tell them, hey, you're not meeting the standard, and you either need to meet the standard or you're no longer going to be on our team. And because of that, we've had lots of people quit and we've had to fire quite a few people.
Do you think any of that is for lack of the job being laid out beforehand? And I'm not saying that this is your guys' fault, but we had on another gentleman, Nate Lenahan, shout out to Twitter. Nate's great. He was talking about hiring people and like how difficult it is to like find good people to hire for your organization. And he was talking about like how he's trying to implement transparency into like the job description and like really lay out, these are the KPIs that I'm wanting you to hit. This is exactly what the job is. And like, this is how we're going to measure you. How are you guys thinking about that? And are any of your past like firings, were any of those a result of lack of kind of putting that out there on your guys' part?
Many of them were because of Frank and I's poor leadership, straight up, right? If you don't tell
someone, I like it.
If you don't tell someone what you expect of them and then they're not living up to it, it is the leader's fault, right? But another way to look at it is when you're in a firefight, you know, like sometimes you just got to be like, shut the fuck up and move, right?
Yeah.
And a startup world is like a firefight, right? Like it'd be a lot easier if we had an unlimited bankroll and, you know, we could have KPIs and we had all these business coaches that told us how to set everything up. But sometimes you're in a firefight that is crazy and you're trying your best. And sometimes, you know, you're an asshole as a leader.
Yeah. I think we also learn that when you have more employees, like you have to also slow down how much you iterate too, right? Like when you have three guys, when we started out, right, just working, just calling people and trying to buy houses and sell houses, you could be so flexible, right? Like, hey, John, you know what? I'll do acquisitions this week. You manage assets. Like you could switch roles and it's not a big deal with three people. You could do anything, you know? But when you have 20 and you shift business goals or your strategies just a little bit left or right, their goals might change and then the expectations change. And it takes people time to go through those mental cycles to understand where you're going. And I think we were definitely susceptible early on to pivoting and like turning up the aggression too much, right? So like we'd have a virtual assistant and be like, hey, this is your responsibility. And then the next month it's like, hey, you're responsible to get a lead a day. You know, we want one qualified lead every day. And like, that's a big shift for that employee, right? That's a big mental shift in terms of their hustle and their daily output. And I think John and I learned that we got to slow down. Like we're super aggressive and, you know, you can do that with yourself, but there's no way to run other people's lives or their business. So I think that's part of the root cause why we've had where we've had a lot of turnover, which is our fault. So,
well, and my father-in-law runs his own business. He's a trim carpenter. So he has his own company where he does finish work and stuff like that. And when I worked with him for a few months while I was transitioning out of the military and I needed some extra cash. And we were talking about, he has such a hard time finding qualified employees. He's just like, I can't find work. And seeing him, you know, I was watching him kind of interact with some of the guys that he was thinking about bringing on. And I eventually like had to tell him like, dude, nobody's going to care about your business as much as you are. Like you're trying to find an employee that's as dedicated to this job as you are. Right. You own the company. Some employee, like you will never find that unless they are financially and emotionally invested into it. And it's not going to happen. I think that was a big eye opener for him. Like, oh no, you're right on that part, because that's what I'm looking for. And I'm not going to find it. You guys, just because, you know, obviously we follow you on Twitter and stuff like that. One thing I want to kind of jump into is the self-storage business. When did you kind of jump into that? And this is one of those businesses that I was telling Brock before we had started, before you guys had jumped on. I was like, this is something that really interests me. And I've kind of been looking into it. So when did you get into that? How did you start?
All right. Yeah. So I'll start. We're doing well in single family. And we had this idea that we wanted to do more, right? Like Frank and I, you could call it ego, you can call it drive, you can call it goal setting, you can call it whatever you want, but we don't want to be the next, you know, chump down the street, right? Like sure. we want to build an awesome company. We want to, you know, have pride in what we're building. Okay. So we're doing single family deals and it was a lot of fun. And we said, we want to do more. Let's look at Opendoor. Let's look at Zillow and let's look at what they're doing. And let's see if we can compete with them, right? Like understand it's a different playing field, but maybe we could get to the point where they would want to acquire us or something like that, right? So we spent, you know, the early part of 2021 going, hey, let's try to do as many houses as we can. And what we realized is the more houses we did, the thinner our margins got, the more fragile our business got. It wasn't a good business strategy. It was a couple months later, we realized, well, Zillow and Opendoor weren't making any money either because they almost lost their entire business. They almost went bankrupt, right? We didn't know that at the time, though. We were trying to emulate them, and we realized it wasn't working for us, okay? So we said, well, what the hell? We're good at marketing. We're good at real estate. We know how to do all this stuff with technology and virtual assistants. What are we going to do? We decided to start looking at commercial real estate. Commercial real estate can mean lots of different things, but ultimately, you know, not a house. Some piece of real estate that's not a house. So most people go to apartments and it's really easy to understand apartments, but there's reasons why we didn't want to go to apartments. Number one, because they're really expensive. Number two is they're hard to manage because people are living there, okay? So we basically looked at two asset classes, one of them being mobile home parks and one of them being storage facilities, right? Because Frank and I kind of pride ourselves in being, you know, somewhat blue collar, right? Maybe that's our veteran roots, right? But this idea of like the blue collar grittiness, sweaty business, where is the best place for us to insert into commercial real estate in one of those avenues? And we thought mobile home parks or self-storage. And we ultimately picked self-storage because it's not someone's primary residence. And we liked the idea of that. If we were going to manage remotely, manage across the country without living there, it'd be nice if it wasn't someone's primary residence. So we said, okay, let's get started in storage. Okay. We're looking at facilities, took some courses, paid for some consulting phone calls to try to get smart. And we found a facility in Lawton, Oklahoma last summer for 1.4. Well, we ended up buying it for $1.4 million. We closed it and things went well. And sometime in late 2021, we started kind of identifying as a real estate private equity company, right? I didn't even know what that meant a year ago, but real estate private equity is just a fancy way of saying investing in real estate full-time, you know, probably in commercial real estate, right? So right now, what Frank and I spend most of our time on is trying to buy storage facilities. We're getting ready to close our second, or actually our third storage facility on Friday, and we're looking for more all the time and happy to kind of go through what our business strategy is and why we think we have an opportunity and an advantage. But that was the genesis of, hey, we feel like we're good at real estate, we're good at technology, we're good at marketing and sales, but trying to play that single family game where you're doing 100 houses a year, it's so much work and the margins getting smaller and smaller that we got to audible. And I think, you know, we're like 9 months into real estate private equity, and I would say we are very happy we made the switch. All signs indicate that it was a great decision for our business and for us personally and our families.
That's awesome. I think that knowing when you kind of need to change and like implementing the change quickly, it sounds like the learning curve was very, very short for you guys getting into that. And it sounds like you guys have had some success in that already, which is fantastic. $1.4 million is a big price tag. Where you guys source that money from yourself? How did you go about getting all that cash to make the purchase?
We raised the money through what they call a syndication, which is, it's basically a fancy word for crowdfunding, I guess you could say. So let's say we used a combination of bank debt and investor money, right? The bank on the first transaction provided 70% of the funds. So right around $1 million. We had a bank agree to give us a loan, assuming we make the down payment, which is in that case, like $400,000+. John and I didn't have 400 grand lying around, but we had some money. We invested some of our cash in the deal, but we needed investors for the rest. So we'll go to people that worked with us in our single family business and people within our network. Those were the primary investors in our first deal. And we said, hey, if you give us X amount of dollars, these are the terms we're going to give you. On that deal, we said, we're going to give you an 8% preferred return, meaning Grayline doesn't get paid profits until they get an 8% return. That's what that means. There's more nuance to it than that, but that's basically what it means. So they get told, hey, you get 8% before Grayline starts taking profit sharing, and then you get this percentage of the proceeds upon sale, right? And here are our financial projections for this facility. This is what we think you'll make based on our best efforts, best guesses, assuming we're good operators and we run this place correctly, right? Investors look at all that stuff and they're like, I'm in or I'm out, you know, like I'm in or I'm out. And you basically raise funds until you have the gap funding required to close. You wire the money, you know, and bank funds, and that's it. That's how it's done.
You guys look at and find this facility, seeing it as an opportunity for like value add, or is that something that you had the idea that like we'll hold on to this and cash flow it? What did you guys see about this specific property that you thought that you would make a good return on?
The number one thing we look for, and John actually does most of this work, is making sure there's room to increase rents. We really want to find facilities where the owner is not realizing all the revenue they can because they're undercharging by 20%, 30%, sometimes 40 something percent, which is what we think the case is with the deal closing on Friday. So that is number one, because storage is very expensive now too, right? They're trading at very, very high prices, which makes cash flow pretty tight based on the price you're paying typically and what the current owner is making. So you really want to look for opportunities where there's a delta, there's a gap that they're not covering, because that's how you're going to increase the value of that property after you buy it, and really what drives the returns for your investors. So you have to find spots where, you know, that stuff's not on Zillow or LoopNet or these websites. Like it's not there. John has to go through and look at comps or comparable facilities for all the ones we underwrite, like check all their rents and see like, is this owner charging enough, right? And we want to find out that delta. Other opportunities are like low occupancy. Any commercial real estate with low occupancy, it's like, what's going on over there, right? Is this run properly? So that's an opportunity. People spending too much on insurance or spending too much on labor. Those are other opportunities we look for.
You guys mess around and like trying to automate places, like making them electronic access, like older outdated facilities that need some modern day 2022 electronics to get into?
Yes, every facility we own, our goal is customers can sign up online, which is another big opportunity. I'd say most mom and pops, their business is not set up so people can rent online and show up and get to their unit. I would say like 60% of them, you can't do that. So our business is you go to our website, you order a unit, you pay, you get a code to the gate. It's sent to your phone. You go to our facility, you type the code in, you put a lock on the unit, or there's a lock waiting for you, and you put your stuff in there and you leave. So you don't have to, it's contactless move-in is the phrase being thrown around in the facility. So we offer contactless move-in for that's a goal of ours for all our facilities.
You said that self-storage is really expensive right now. Is that a byproduct of real estate and interest rates as a whole? Is it that sweaty startup guy on Twitter, like telling everybody they need to get into self-storage, like the tomato guy? I know you know who I'm talking about. Why is it so expensive?
It's just a booming economy, right? The economy's been booming for a long time. Interest rates are super low. A lot of people have money. So what happens when a lot of people have money? Well, at a certain point, people want to take money off the table and take it out of the stock market and put it into real estate, right? Well, you know, they start with multifamily, big apartment complexes, right? They go to maybe, you know, big shopping malls and stuff, right? But eventually, if there's a ton of money out there, it starts trickling down. And what's like what's the redheaded stepchild of commercial real estate? Mobile home parks and self-storage, right? So when self-storage prices are going up, what's that mean? That means there's a lot of money in the economy. Interest rates are low. The economy is booming so much that even at the very bottom, the redheaded stepchild storage prices are starting to go up quite a bit.
What does the, so on like a typical storage, self-storage unit, what does the return look like on something like that?
No, I think it would look like, you know, you could do the math just like you would on any other commercial real estate asset, right? Like if we were going to say a $5 million storage facility versus a $5 million apartment complex, like the return potentially could be the exact same. It's just like that maybe the $5 million apartment complex has 50 units and the $5 million storage facility has 500, right? But ultimately sure. What you're trying to do is you're trying to get, you know, for that money, the most return possible. So I don't think you could say, hey, in multifamily, you're going to get X and in storage, you're going to get Y. I think the differences are, one, the loan products are different. So we're right around 4.25% or so for a loan, where if you were going to get it with multifamily, a multifamily product, you could probably get in the twos right now, right? So that, what does that mean? That means that the price will probably be higher for the multifamily because you can get cheaper debt on it. Another big thing is with storage, we can change prices on a month-to-month basis. We usually change it quarterly. But what that means is with inflation and prices going crazy, we can hit those projections faster, where a multifamily facility is going to have to wait usually 12 months to turn that stuff over. So I wouldn't say, hey, if you're comparing a multifamily and a storage, you should go one way or the other. I think they're both unique, and you'd have to really dig into both of them to figure out that opportunity.
Yeah. I mean, they both have aspects of being a small business. Like there's a leasing operation with multifamily development. There's all this stuff, but storage feels more like a small business to me than other commercial real estate assets in my brief experience. Like you're running Google ads for, hey, sign up and come to my facility, right? Like you're doing a Google My Business page. Like you get Google reviews, you try to get testimonials, you got a website that's customer facing in that manner. So some people do retail sales out of their storage facility. They sell boxes, packaging, whatever. So storage to me feels like it's got real estate financing and it's valued like real estate, but it's got this little like small business feel to it. And sometimes you can take advantage of that for profit, right? Like you can sell insurance with your units. Some people do sell U-Hauls out of their facilities. So there's a little bit of like small business added revenue you can realize. But like John said, I agree with everything else he said.
The one thing I would add too that I really like about storage is if you look at a 10 by 10 storage facility at our complex versus a 10 by 10 storage facility across the street, chances are those are going to rent or those should rent for almost the exact same price, right? Like almost the exact same price because it's a commodity. It's a metal box, right? Where when you start looking at apartment complexes, it's really easy to be like, well, this one, you know, this one's got granite countertops and this one, you know, has got a different color. It's been updated. So what does that mean? If you're going to invest in one of these assets, in my opinion, right, I think it's really easy for investors to bullshit people. It's really easy for investors to be like, you know, hey, it's renting for $800 now, but we're going to put $10,000 into it. And then it's going to rent for $1,400. And if an investor goes, well, why do you think that? Oftentimes, I think you end up getting some bullshit answer where with storage, if someone is looking at one of our underwriting deals, be like, how are you going to raise it from $70 a unit to $100 a unit? We're going to be like, hey, this is why. Here are three facilities by us that are charging more than 100, and we're just underwriting it at 100. But if you look at that, yeah, there's probably even more meat on the bone here, right? So it doesn't mean everyone in multifamily is an idiot or an asshole, but it means what we're doing, I think, is simple, and we can prove out kind of our projections in a more clear manner, in my opinion.
Yeah, much easier to compare. Like you said, they're comparing literally a box to another box rather than, you know, this one's got two parking spaces versus one. It's not the apples and oranges. According to your guys' website, you guys do take third-party money. Is that right?
Well, that's referring to the limited partners of the investors I mentioned earlier. So that's, you know, we... we are always constantly looking for people to invest in our deals. There's, you know, that benefits investors, but that helps us scale, right? Like, John and I don't come from money. So like, I can't ask an uncle for $2 million if we come across a awesome $6 million facility, and I know neither can John, right? So in order for us to scale and reach our goals, the capital raising is part of our business. It's actually one of the core functions. So it's on us to deliver good returns, but it's also on us to network and find people that want to place money in alternative assets, because that's how businesses like ours grow.
What and this may be part of like the pitch that you give people that are interested in being limited partners or LPs. What kind of time horizon do you guys advertise that you'd like to take when you're looking for deals? Do you have like a hurdle rate or like we're going to target things that are going to make over X amount for our non-finance listeners, a hurdle rate? Walk us through that kind of like pitch to somebody that may be interested in investing with you guys. And if there's, I'm assuming you guys might have a minimum of what you're willing to take on from people.
Yeah, we take 25 grand as our minimum right now. I don't think we have plans to change it. Our first deal, we had a preferred return of 8, but we had a higher promote or profit share on the back end. And our most recent deal, we did a 6% with a lower profit share in the back end. And I think we're going to stick with that model going forward. You know, we're only, 7-8 months into this business. So I never want to say that we're never going to change again, right? It's still early, but that's the model I think we're going to go forward with. But to your point, bringing up a preferred return, some people don't offer a pref. Some people offer like just a bigger profit share to the investors and no pref. But I think it is important nowadays to have a hurdle. Like I think investors, in my experience, they want a hurdle in there, at least in the 7 months or so that I've been doing it. So we do offer one.
And then yeah. I would say our, every project could be different, but the last project we did is projected to be a 5-year hold, right? But we definitely tell investors that we have long-term debt. So if we have a softening of the economy and we have to hold it longer in order to make it a great investment, that's what we'll do, right? So it's not locked in for 5 years, but generally we're looking at five years, right? And then we say, you know, we try our best to have a conservative risk adjusted return. And for our last deals, what we've told investors is somewhere between 15 and 20% internal rate of return when it's all said and done. And we happy to talk through all the math and all the assumptions we made with our investors to do that. And I would also, you know, if any of the stuff we're talking about how to structure a deal confuses anyone, but they want to invest in a deal, if you talk to someone like me, ask all those questions, right? Like, what does this mean? What does this mean? How do I get paid? What if I want out? Just ask all those questions. And any syndicator or investor that can't answer those questions or won't answer those questions, you, in my opinion, probably shouldn't do business with them anyways.
Yeah, that's probably good advice. Does the profit share, is that something that comes on the back half? And does that come from like at the point of like selling or where does that come from?
So let's use the 8% preferred return example. So the investor in our business, we're doing quarterly distributions, right? So that would mean, hey, Q1, you're getting 2%. And you get 2% every quarter until you hit 8. That's your 8% preferred return for that calendar year. When John and I meet that or start hitting those returns, which we are on the first facility, we then can start taking profit sharing once the investor is on track to hit their pref, right? On sale, let's say we sell 5 years from now, right? You basically have to look at how much money you've made and how much you distributed to investors over that 5-year time horizon. And you have to see, did I deliver an 8% return every single year? Has the investor gotten that amount of money, right? That is equal to 8% per year. You have to hit that and then you start taking profit sharing, right? So they have to have an average annual rate of return of 8% for you to start taking that promote on the sale of that property, right? If you fall behind, let's say you fall behind $20,000, right? And you sell it and you make $100,000 on the sale. You got to catch the investors up before you start taking profit sharing. So when you start falling behind in the prep, that starts to turn into a debt really on the part of the sponsor that has to be fulfilled before you make any money. So that's how it works.
Well, and I think that the preferred way is a nice way to do business for both sides. And I think primarily because it aligns incentives. You know, they have preferred stock in publicly traded companies for a reason, because people want to be higher up on the capitalization table. You know, they want to be paid first if something goes wrong, and, you know, the debt holders get paid first, and then them, and then kind of slowly move down. So you guys have a goal of reaching 20 million this year. You want to walk us through where you came up with that number, how far you are, and what's next for Grayline?
Yeah, let me first, just on the preferred return and stuff, I would just say Frank and I try to keep it simple. It's really easy to make it very complicated, so we try to keep it super simple. And then the other thing we try to do is align incentives, which means we want to be incentivized in as close of a manner as the investors are incentivized. So we're always motivated to act in our investor best interests, right? And it's really hard to have those incentives be perfect, but that's what we try to do. And then, you know, when in doubt, we try to say, hey, what is the going standard for fees and how much profit share we should take? And then we try to back it up just a little bit, because we want to make sure we're always being fair to our investors, right? And then, yeah, going into this year, our goal is to buy $20 million worth of storage. We just had an appraisal come back today, which means we should close a facility on Friday. That should put us, right around $5.5 million. So we're going to be on
$5.5 million mid February. It sounds like you guys weren't crazy enough in that goal. Might need to bump those. We got to bump those up a little bit.
We started out with 1.4, right? Because we had already closed one. So I guess our goal is 18 and a half for the year. You know, the 20 sounds much cooler, I guess. So we're just going to rock 20. But yeah, it'll be 5.6 hopefully at the end of this week. So we're on track, I guess, is where we're at.
But I think that goal, is it a motivator? Yes. But I'm relatively calm. Like, if we don't hit 20 million, it's because we decided not to hit 20 million because we couldn't find good enough deals. Like, right. We're confident we can find the deals. We can partner with investors. We can get the debt. We feel good about that. I think the 20 million, although it's a big number, and a year ago it would have blown my mind, I'm really comfortable with the number 20 million. I like the number 20 million because it's not 40 million and it's not 100 million. And Frank and I really, if you've listened to this podcast at all, you hear a theme of us just hitting the throttle and being like, let's fucking go, baby. Right. And we said, hey, we want to be a great real estate private equity company. And we feel like we can absolutely grow to $20 million this year while staying within ourselves by growing, you know, a very resilient company. And if we tried to go to 40 million, we felt like we would have stressed our systems too much and potentially put capital or assets at risk. So 20 million is a big, exciting number, and we're super pumped about it. But it's also a little bit of a throttle gauge for us to say, hey, we want to be on that glide path. It's okay to be a little above it or a little below it. But if we're doubling that, we need to look at our team and make sure we're actually resourced, because right now we are not resourced to buy $50 million worth of storage this year. We are resourced to buy $20 million.
Well, and I think that that's the right way to look at it, because we don't want to buy $20 million just at any cost. You know, if you're losing money on buying $20 million of real estate, like, so what? Like, you know, that's not a good thing. And it also sounds like you guys have, I don't want to say learned your lesson. I'm not here to poo-poo you guys, but like, that sounds like direct implementation of this past lesson that you guys have learned with, like, maybe growing too quickly, taking on too many employees, and like people that aren't exactly all aligned on the team, you know, and causing a problem for your employees, working yourselves extra, all of that.
I think we learned a lesson that, I think you're correct. I think we also learned, like, obviously we're not the first storage owners that ever lived. There's thousands of us before us, and there'll be millions after us. There's other people that have invested in single family for last 150 years, whatever, however long people have been doing this stuff. And I think John and I probably came in and we're like, those idiots, they don't know what they're doing. We're going to completely transform how this is done. And like, the mature business owner is like, hey, there's a reason people grew their businesses in the way they did it. You know, this isn't some transformative tech startup, right? We're we're replicating existing businesses. And I think it's probably some arrogance on our part, right? Like, hey, we'll do single family like no one's ever done it before, right? Like in our heads. And we look at storage and we're like, hey, like there's a reason you have to build this thing slowly, right? You can't take investor money and then have one person managing like seven different facilities, right? It's just not, you can't have your business outpace operations that much. And you start looking at other business owners, how they grew their companies. And I think we realize we have to replicate some of those steps before we take bigger risks, right? We got to like do what the things that the smart people do and then branch off from there. So we got humbled. And I think we're learning that lesson.
That's a great, great point. And I don't know if this is one of your guys' final questions, but if you were going to ask, what advice would I have for a veteran, right? I think that's something that veterans get wrong. I got wrong. Frank got wrong, right? It's like, veterans that have this entrepreneurial spirit, I feel like they're told they need to create something that's never existed before. Like you can do that, but the odds are so much against you. Like you're going to create a new kind of sunglasses, right? Or like some new restaurant concept or this, that, and the other. I would much rather advise veterans out there that want to be entrepreneurs, like what businesses in your town are good and how can you copy them, right? It might not be as sexy and you might not be on the cover of Fortune magazine next year, but the odds of that being successful are going to be so much higher than creating something new, in my opinion. It might sound negative to say that, but I think it needs to be said by lots of people.
You keep going, man. I'm right there with you. I think that, and this is, I'm not speaking bad about anybody else. I'm speaking because I have like experienced this, but like have that same sort of entrepreneurial drive and like this desire to kind of like have the next great thing that's never existed before. And like you said, I think that the pace of innovation, what we see on as like consumers differs very greatly than what the reality is. You know, it just, there might be new terms for things, but there's really not a lot that's new. I got into it with somebody on Twitter a couple of weeks ago. They're like, everybody's all about DAOs now, you know, in Web3, these decentralized autonomous organizations or whatever. They're like, what if we just set up a DAO for like, you know, we all just buy a house and then different people can use it. And I was like, so a timeshare like that literally already exists, like, and it has for a really long time. Like everything doesn't need to be more complicated than it is. But I think you're right. There's a ton of opportunity and just really simple businesses for people. And you can kind of buy yourself a job in a way. If you're really not sure what you want to do, you really can go out and get a small business loan and buy yourself a full-time job if you want. And if you've got a little bit of business acumen, I think veterans are fantastic entrepreneurs, and entrepreneurs in the sense, not of like creating something necessarily, but just operators in general.
Yeah. And the financing to buy businesses is like, as you guys are said, you're looking at businesses too, is pretty cool. Like you can acquire businesses on seller financing, just like you can a house. You can do an SBA loan. The leverage on those things is like crazy high. You can do like almost 90% loan to value, I think, on those, which is kind of like a VA loan, you know?
Yeah.
But it's like for a business. So like, yeah, like if a business is struggling and you get a good deal, I agree 100%, man. 100%. I meant to ask, what businesses are you guys looking at?
Self-storage was one that really interests me. For me personally, something that's a little bit more hands-off, like I would want it to be my full-time gig, but like self-storage, car wash, something like that, where there's not a ton of overhead, but is like pretty self-sufficient, so to speak. That type of thing, those types of things that would be what interests me the most.
Yeah, I have similar feelings and kind of ran into the wall of like understanding the time commitment required for doing something like that. As I'm sure that you guys could speak to, like not every deal is right. And sometimes you have to combat that like excitement of like seeing something so good. And that doesn't mean that it's just right for you, you know?
I think it's really easy. I bought an ice cream shop one time and owned an ice cream shop for a couple years.
Okay. Now we're getting into the juicy stories here.
Right? It was a great learning experience. But one of the lessons there that I think everyone needs to learn is when you look at a business, you can think like, you know, whatever. I sold 1,000 ice cream cones last year. And this year I'm going to sell 1,500 ice cream cones. Right. Well, anyone who's been in the ice cream business is going to like be like, dude, you're going to increase your ice cream sales by 50%. How are you going to do that? And you're like, I'm going to do stuff on social media. I'm going to have a cool sign. They're going to be like, hey, that might give you 5%, but you're not going to sell 50% more ice cream this year. Right. But so many people going into a business are just like, I think I can do it. And, you know, many of us coming out of the military are confident enough. Right. And we got the chutzpah to believe we can do it. But the bottom line is you're probably not going to be able to.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. Like we veterans, I think they can do more operational value add to a business than is what is reality, right? In reality, what are the primary determinants of pricing and how well that small business in small town USA is? It's probably the health of the town and the location of the asset itself, right? If it's like an ice cream shop, like if the location's badass for an ice cream shop and the town's doing really well and there's people walking, dude, you're going to crush it, right? If not, like there's no social media account that's going to make people go to like the most dangerous part of Lawton, Oklahoma to get ice cream. Like that shit ain't happening, you know? So like, I think vets have to be careful. Like, don't think the previous owner is that stupid. They're probably not that dumb, right? They're probably pretty sharp. So you got to respect them and be like, how much can I really improve this thing?
Rainbow sprinkles, hold the stabbing, please.
Yeah, right? Like the market gets a vote.
Analyze the business on how it's currently performing. Like, is it a good deal on how it's currently performing? Because if it's only a good deal, if you sell 50% more ice cream cones, that means it's not a good deal.
Right. Makes sense. That was the interesting thing with talking with Nate is, Frank, you were talking about like how the financing on buying small businesses is so cool. That I never even like considered that until we had done that interview with Nate. And I, for like weeks after that, I was like, oh, this is like really plausible. Like, this is not something you need to have millions of dollars in the bank to do. Like, your normal blue collar worker with a little bit of money in the bank can like most definitely buy a business. And I really like what you said, Brock, about like you're buying your own job essentially, which is like a super interesting way to think about it.
I've said a bunch of times before, like I got out and I was like, I knew in that moment that I long-term wanted to work for myself. And I have a hard time thinking that there's not other people that think that way. I know that there are other people that feel the same and kind of like want to build something for themselves. And it sounds like you guys have that same kind of drive.
Yeah, maybe we're too difficult to work for somebody else too. You know, that might be it. I think, you know, vets, it's probably a lot of us that, you know, I mean, every veteran officer or NCO or non-commissioned, you know, have been told to like shovel shit at some point, right? Like, hey, go shovel some shit. And a lot of people don't like that, you know? Mm-hmm. So it's natural for you to do that for 5 to 7 years or maybe longer and be like, hey, like, I want to try to create some upside in my life and create my own thing, right? And that upside is either through making a lot of money or earning back a lot of time. So I think vets have that perspective. And when they leave, they're like, I'm gonna try to make this work for me now. You know, I work for the man for a while. I'm gonna try to make this economy work for me. And I think a lot of vets do well because of that.
And I think it's not necessarily that it shouldn't be taken with the perception that you're not gonna have to do hard work. You're still gonna have to shovel shit, but there's a difference when you talk about like, I want more of the upside.
It's your shit.
That's what I was just about to say. It's your shit.
You're shoveling your own shit.
Yes. Yeah, exactly. Right. That's what I was just about to say.
Well, you take away the upside. You're really only limited as much as you want to work or you want to acquire new locations or whatever it is. Like that upside kind of boundary is taken away, which I think that's unique and motivating to the types of people we're talking about.
I think it also like kind of gives you like this weird chip on your shoulder too, for like when you do work with somebody. Like, obviously I went from being in the Navy to selling cars, and like we were screwing around one day at work and they were like, okay, I need everybody to like go outside and reset the radio or like something stupid. Like, it was like most definitely busy work and everybody's like bitching and complaining about it. I'm like, I've literally mopped rain. Like, Like, this is not like this is not hard. You know what I mean? Like, this isn't, and people are like, this is bullshit, blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, dude, I've literally mopped rain in the middle of a monsoon. Like, get over it. You know what I mean? Like, whatever.
Yeah.
That gives you a little bit of an edge, I think, when you do work for somebody as well.
Yeah. Take your bags and move it from this container to this other container.
Yes. Yes.
Like, how many times exactly. Has everyone done that? You know?
Well, cool. I want to kind of wrap up here. Want to get some parting advice from you guys. John, you kind of dropped some wisdom a little bit earlier. So maybe Frank, you might just be on the hook now. What are some opportunities maybe that you guys have seen in your line of work that maybe isn't totally in your line of work, or some kind of advice for other veterans that are maybe looking to get into the small and medium business space, get into real estate?
Well, I think
what should people be doing?
Well, there's one thought I've had recently is to complement our existing business. We're not doing this yet, but we could, is this thought around when people are in a gold rush, like it's good to hand out shovels, right? Like that phrase, I'm not saying it correctly, but when there's a gold rush, be the one handing out the shovels, right? And I've thought about our direct mail that we send out to storage owners, and John too, and a lot of our communications, like we want to buy your facility, right? We're doing marketing to buy the facility. But I think when asset prices are really high, that people are going to be willing to pay prices for consultative services on their assets, right? So what does that look like? We message a storage owner like, hey, we'll help you run a better facility and charge you for our services. We're going to increase your top line revenue, and based on our performance, because you'll be able to sell it at a higher price, and we'll take some share of profits or a flat fee or something like that. So I think a big opportunity right now is like consulting, right? There's so many people with assets that are worth so much money, car washes, storage facilities, all this crap, property management companies, whatever. And the multiples are so good that if you could help them increase the value of their assets, your services are worth a shit ton of money. There's a guy that makes millions of dollars increasing revenue for gyms. So he was on the My First Million podcast last week and I listened to it. He just goes to gyms, increases their revenue, takes a share of the profits that he gives them by following his process and moves on to the next gym. That's his whole business. So that's like
such a good episode.
Shovels, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. Alex Hermazzi.
Yeah, I forgot his name.
I started listening to some of his like old podcasts and he's a real deal. He's like a cold blooded salesman for sure.
Yeah. He's smooth, man. He's very smooth.
Yeah. No, I think that's good advice and a way to leverage kind of some knowledge that you have about like a pre-existing business or whatever into kind of more of a, I guess, service-based business rather than just a traditional brick and mortar. John, anything from you? Any parting thoughts?
Yeah, I think my advice for any veteran out there is to take care of themselves. I maybe am the touchy-feely guy, right? But I see too many veterans that they get out and they gain a bunch of weight and they don't work out and they treat their body like shit. And, you know, the military gets a lot of things wrong, but one of the things they get right is trying to do physical fitness every day, right? So you don't have to be crazy, but I think it's so sad to see so many young veterans that are, you know, 25, 35 years old, and they look like they're like 45 or 55, right? So, you know, my advice to any veteran out there is if you want all the financial goals, I'm a big believer in how you do anything is how you do everything, right? So if you want to be an awesome dad, you know, be an awesome business professional. If you want to be an awesome business professional, like wake up early, work out, eat right, take care of yourself. To me, it's all interconnected. And, you know, in too many veteran circles, we're all talking about being badasses and, you know, super macho. And I'm like, hey, take care of yourself, man. Like, make sure you're getting sleep. Make sure you're staying hydrated. Make sure you're working out. It's going to help you in every facet of life. Like I said, maybe I'm the touchy-feely guy by saying that, but I think it's a message that as veterans, we don't talk about enough.
You got to be getting good sleep, eating right, and be physically there to kind of show up every day. So I'd agree with you 100%. Where can people go to find to follow along with you guys? I know we've got people blowing us up asking how they can get invested with Grayline. If you guys want to plug the business, where can people find you?
Yeah, our website is graylineinvestments.com. If you go with the G-R-A-Y, if you're confused on how to spell gray, some people think it's E-Y. And You can go there to sign up to get access to our deals. And then a Twitter, I'm Frank at Frank Scapp, and he's at John Plumstead. That's it.
Perfect. You guys dropped some good content on Twitter. Happy to be following you guys and here for finding out weird things that our wives dream about us.
Yes. I don't, let's move on from Twitter and close it out, because I got destroyed on Twitter last night. And I had a marriage tweet. I went out of my comfort zone with a tweet and it did not go well. And I took it down because I started going viral in a bad way. Hate mail coming in. And honestly, the way I wrote it, reflecting on it, I shouldn't have wrote it. It was partly my fault. You know,
can you tell us what it is? We can cut this if you want, but
you don't have to cut it. But I wrote something like about marriage being a production based business. Like, with the thought in my head is like, hey, you got to show up to work every day, like be a good dad, like try to improve yourself as a human. And I've just seen a lot of mostly men like let it go and slip, and then they're upset when their wife is unhappy with them and they leave. And I'm like, no, that's your, in my head, I'm like, that's your fucking fault. You know, that's my attitude. And I think that way for myself too. But the way people took it is like, you must be really hard on your wife, right? And or like not a very compassionate human. Some people called me worse than that. And you could, and then religious people who believe you should never get divorced, they started going like, no, like you took a vow.
Oh, God, no.
God, you know, you're breaking the sacrament. And I got that crowd coming after me, which I probably should have expected, but I did not. And then and also the way I wrote it was just not very like tactful. So then some other peers were like, take the shit down, you dummy, you know? So it didn't go well. Like, that was my first time I went viral in a bad way ever. And it sucked. Like, it was not cool. Like, I realized like the risks of social media now, and it was not fun.
Yeah. Sometimes you want to get out there and like get seen and whatever, but it's always like, you kind of like let your guard down on like some verbiage or something, and it will come back and bite you.
I didn't even pay attention to it, man. I put zero thought into it, and it fucking occupied my entire night. and then I shut it down.
Also one of those things, like Twitter's such like, I like Twitter, but it's also such a terrible place where you're like, you tweet like 200 tweets and none of them do any good. And then you just have some random one that you never think is going to do good. And then you check 2 hours later and you've got 47 notifications. You're like, what? Wait a second. What is going on?
Yep.
Yeah. It's a weird platform, but man, deep down the rabbit hole with it for sure. I pump it on like every single episode that we do here. So there's a ton of value there to be had. John, Frank, thank you guys so much. This has been fantastic. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you. For sure. Brock, Tim, really appreciate it.
Yeah. Thanks, man.
Thanks so much for tuning in today. Your listenership helps me better educate people like you and the rest of our nation's military, both past and present, on building a successful life outside of military service. If you're looking for more ways the top vets are leading more effective lifestyles, building businesses, and using the resources designed specifically for you, press here for a selection of some of the best clips. Be sure to like this video and subscribe to the channel to stay up to date, and I will be talking with you soon.